Welcome everybody to the session Doing Wonders with the WebDriver by Sudarshan. We are glad they could join us today. Without any further delay, over to you, Sudarshan.
Hey, thanks a lot for the awesome introduction. So before going into the session, I would really like to thank the people who really wanted to attend this session. So considering Saturday evening, instead of spending time with the loved ones, you guys plan to attend this session. So it's really very great, and I'm really thankful for you guys. So the session which today I'm going to host is Doing Wonders with the WebDriver. By seeing the title, you may all wonder like what's the wonder that's gonna rely on with the WebDriver, right? So the main reason why I chose this topic is like, so currently if you see like the lot of automation tools are getting introduced and people now start showing interest to learn these tools. But the problem is that like in the fundamentals of understanding what the tool is and what purpose the tool gonna serve, right? So if you take any fresher who recently started working with any automation tool, the first thing they think is like these automation tools are only meant for testing, but that's not true, right? So to understand the tool, we first understand what problem it's gonna solve. Later we should try to learn other aspects of the tool, right? So to get a better understanding and to try to teach the freshers like how the tool can be efficiently used, I have came up with some of the fun things which can be done using a WebDriver, and I will be showcasing those demos in this upcoming session. So without further ado, I will start the session. So this is the code that if you open the Selenium dev homepage, this will be the first thing you will see. And for me, this is so true that Selenium automates browser. That's it. What you do with the power ended up to you. So this is so true, right? So Selenium has like nothing specific to do with testing. So it's just a tool that automates the browser. So what we're going to do with this tool is completely subject to for the user who going to use it. So yeah. So hi. So I'm Sudarshan Selvaraj. I'm currently working as a SDET at Jumio in Bangalore. So I have like around 8 years of experience in test automation, and I'm so passionate about learning like new automation tools, technology, and love building frameworks around the tools. So if you have like any questions or something, you can reach me through LinkedIn or through my GitHub. These are my handles. So yeah. Okay. The first thing like which I would like to showcase is like I think like at least once in your lifetime you might have played this game in Google Chrome when the internet is down, right? So like I like during the pandemic time when I was very active in LinkedIn, like I saw a lot of posts around several engineers like trying to play this game automatically using some AI ML or using Arduino and all. So then later I got a thought. So like this game is running inside a browser and Selenium can automate the browser. So why not we use Selenium to automate the game? So I got very interested to automate this, and I came up with a simple like around 100 line solution to automate this game purely using Selenium. So I will quickly show a demo of it. So for this, I use Selenium with Java and just the Chrome browser, nothing else. No fancy library or anything. So let me run this program for you. So you may all think I might be playing. So it's not. The script is automatically playing the game now. So like still the algorithm needs to be like hard coded, because as the game progresses, the speed of the dyno will already get increased. So it's kind of like a simple mathematical calculation on like determining when the jump needs to be made. So I will not dig much deep inside the technical aspect, but I can like give you an overview on how I actually automated it. So before that, I will go ahead and put my internet in offline. Okay, so this is the page we are trying to automate here. So if you inspect it, all you will get is a simple canvas element. Okay, so this is the canvas element inside which the game is completely rendered. So there is no way we can inspect the individual elements like this dino or whatever the obstacle is going up. So we need some other way to determine where the dino is, where the obstacle is, what's the game speed, everything, right? So to get this, if you open the console and if you type for this run now, you will get a function like this. And there is another object called instance, which holds the complete context of the game here. So if you inspect here, you can see, instance.obstacles. So this will give the list of obstacles as the game progresses. Okay, it's not obstacles, it's horizon. So you'll get all the information like what is the position, what type of obstacle it is. Same applicable for the dino as well. So this object holds where the dino's position is, what's the game speed. So all those information will be obtained from the T-Rex. So now it's just a matter of having a while loop and keep on determining what's the position of this dino and what's the position of the obstacle and calculating the optimal distance and just with the space bar. So that's a very simple thing which we need to do to automate this game. So I will just include the source code as part of the presentation. And you can also give it a try and you can optimize it so that we can reach a high score, right? So this is one thing which I wanted to share with you all. So going next, so this is another project which I did to play songs using online piano. So since childhood days, I was very fond to music and I wanted to learn music, but unfortunately I couldn't able to. But recently when I tried to play this online piano, I tried really hard and I couldn't able to succeed. Then I really got an idea why not I should automate this piano using Selenium. And I written a simple script. Again, this is going to be around 100 line script just to play a few songs in the online piano. So I will again show a demo. So if you can, guess what song I'm going to play. So for this again, I'm using Java with Selenium here. So this is going to be song number 2. So next is going to be song number 3. So yeah, so I hope you all can guess the second and third song, right? Okay, the second one is Game of Thrones theme and the last one is the Coffin Dance, the meme that got really famous during the COVID time. So that's the third song. So coming to the next project. So this is also another project which I did to solve online web-based Rubik's Cube. So the algorithm, it's like we use a different library which will give us the like a list of steps to solve the Rubik's Cube. That's something which I haven't done. So the core part which aims here is like how we gonna like automate the UI, like, because this is one of the complex HTML structure I have seen in my entire career. So I wanted to really automate this. So like I took it up as a challenge and I completed it. I will also quickly show a demo of it. So I have done this using Node.js and Selenium in JavaScript. So we can run it. So initially, like the website inbuilt has a shuffle functionality, so it will just randomly shuffles the cube. So once the shuffle is complete, like we will try solving the cube using the script. So now the shuffling has been completed. So you can also see the steps like what we are performing. Like it will take like 5 more minutes, so I will like stop it because it will take a long time. So this is like kind of a like demonstration how like we need to handle the HTML elements, right? So if you take this, like I would like you all to like go to this website and try to see how the HTML is structured and try to write a simple script just to move a row or column, because this is like a kind of a complex thing to automate. So With just the HTML, you cannot automate this. You also need some information from this cube object. So this tells like which cube is facing forward and what are the colors, how you need to switch. So all this information is available in this cube object. So with this information, you all can also try to automate this as well. So I will again share the source code in the my PowerPoint presentation. You all can take a look. So the next thing would be, so SpaceX docking simulator. So like recently, like last year, I guess SpaceX has launched a new capsule which has a HTML and CSS based user interface, which is used to dock the capsule to the ISS simulator. So this is the site which SpaceX has recently launched to see how the interface looks, and user can like actually try it out, and they can dock the shuttle to the space station. So even if you try it manually, it's really hard for you to manually dock it, because like there are like lot of things to be considered simultaneously to achieve this. So as you can see, now I am like performing some action, but if you don't perform any action, it will automatically move its position, because there is no gravity in space, right? So I tried to automate it considering all the different aspects, and finally I was able to successfully dock it with the International Space Station. So this is kind of a very long script, and it took around like 10 to 15 minutes for the automation to get completed. So I cannot able to show a complete demo, but I can like quickly run you through a video which I have already recorded. So everything is happening through the script. So this is also one of the complex web page to be automated. So I recommend you all to give it a try and see, like, if you can able to automate this. Yeah, so this is one of the projects which I wanted to show all. So moving on to next, handling HTML canvas is one of the toughest job in automation. So especially like there are like some applications where you want to validate the signatures which is written in the HTML canvas, right? So like I wanted to come up with a solution where like you, if, let's say I have a signature as an image file, why not use that image file and draw the same signature in the canvas using the HTML. So with that intent, I created a simple library which uses Selenium to read an image and using that image and draw it in the HTML canvas. So for that also, like I don't have the setup currently in my machine, but I can show you a quick demo. So this is the one here. So what we're gonna do here is, so we're gonna try to draw the same image instead, like without the colors, just the outline onto a HTML canvas. So this is a web page which has a canvas and has the ability to draw. So the entire sketching thing is like purely done using a Selenium's action class. So no fancy libraries. So this is going to be how the output is going to look. So the underlying algorithm here is like, so for any given image, we will convert that image and find the outline using some ML algorithm. So from this outline, we can easily find out what are all the, where are the white pixels resides. And based on the white pixels path, we will just using the action class and we will plot the dots in the HTML canvas. So that's the underlying like technique which I have followed. So that's one thing. Okay, so moving now, like we have seen some of the cool projects using WebDriver. I know WebDriver is already great, but still there are like a few gaps which WebDriver currently doesn't support. So to fill those gaps, like I have also written few libraries to overcome those limitations and make WebDriver great again. So that's the thing which we're gonna see in this upcoming session. So the first library which I would like to introduce is called as PyDriver. So if you all attended the previous sessions about APM plugins, you might have got an idea like how the plugin works and what are all the APM plugin functionalities, right? So one of the key functionalities of the APM plugin is like you can able to modify the existing behavior of a method, right? So in case like there is a find element method, you have the ability to modify the functionality of the find element, either perform something before the find element method is called or perform something after the find element method is called, right? So currently WebDriver lacks this functionality. I would not say lack because we already have a class called event driven event WebDriver, but if you're going to use the event driven WebDriver, you cannot typecast it to the original base WebDriver. Let's say you're going to create a WebDriver for a Chrome driver. You cannot typecast back into Chrome driver when you use the event driven web driver here. So what I did is like I created a new utility called PyDriver where you can register a listener and listen for all the method calls made on a web driver and a web element. So if you're gonna let's say you got a called a method called driver.get, you can perform certain action before the driver.get executes and perform certain action after the driver.get method has been executed. So I can like walk you through some examples and real time use cases. Okay, so first let's consider a simple automation script. What this script will do is it will just open the Selenium's homepage and it will move to the download section and it will just find the latest grid version and it will print it out. So now I will just run this function. Okay. So okay, so it has printed out 3.1.1.1.59. So this is how the normal test would look, right? But now what I wanted is like I wanted to log all the actions that has been performed in the same test. Okay, so if I want to log actions currently, so for each and every method I have to go and I have to say okay logger dot log navigated to home page. Again for each and every step I have to go and add a log step. So instead of doing it, what we can do is like we can use this leverage the functionality of the spy driver. So it's very simple. We just create a spy driver for whatever web driver we're going to create. So in this case, we can use Chrome driver, but this supports all web driver. You can use Firefox driver or remote web driver, whatever web driver you want, we can use it. After that, you want to add a listener. So listener is something which the spy driver will use to notify us. Like so, whenever some event happens on this driver object, this listener will be called using the spy driver. So I will explain about this listener later. So once this listener has been registered, we want to obtain this spy driver because this driver will be spied with the spy driver and it will create proxy object. So using which we're going to continue our automation now. So now I will quickly run this and I will show how the logs will be printed. So this is the same code which I have executed before. I haven't modified anything else. So if you can see, now you can tell, right? So before driver.get is called with the parameter this. So before driver.findElement is called with by link text as the parameter downloads. So after that, we are clicking on the element with the link text downloads, and we are finding an element with some XPath, and we are getting the text of that particular element and we are printing. So this is how the logs are generated. Now I will show how the logic for printing the logs is written. So this is a listener class which implements a spy driver listener. So there is a interface which defines what are all the callback methods that is supported by the spy driver. There are like two different types of events. One is for driver events and one other is for element events. So all method calls that happens on a web driver will be called for driver command executor, and all actions that are executed on an element will be received by the element command executor. So there are two aspects there: before driver command executed and after driver command executed. So this is before executing any command on the driver, this method will be called, and after a command has been executed, you can use this callback to perform the action here. So this is kind of a simple use case where you will be adding the logs, right? But using this library, you can use like lot more functionality to our existing automation test. So there are like few other things which I have created using this library, which I will show in the next slides. So this is SpyDriver. So the next one is WoWXSR. So currently, if you use Selenium for your automation test, so mocking the API request is one of the toughest job to do now. So if you want to mock any API request in the browser, either you have to go for any like proxies like browser mob or something like that to mock the API response. But the problem is like if the setup is going to be in local, it's okay. It's very simple. You just create a proxy attaching it to the driver and you will be executing it. But if you want to execute in like a distributed system, or if you want to execute the test in some remote environment or using browsers like or something, the setup is kind of like a pain here. So to overcome those things, I have created again a simple utility. It's very lightweight. It doesn't use any proxies internally to mock any API request or response and to get all API logs. So there is some scenarios where like you also need to capture the API request made by the browser for better debugging. Sometimes during automation script, there might be some APIs that may be randomly failing and it will be really hard for us to debug it. So using WoW XSR, you will be able to completely get the list of API calls made by the browser along with its request body, response body, headers, everything. So I will just quickly show a demo of this as well. Okay, so for that I have a sample application ready for testing here. So initially, like when you load this application, we have two different tables. One is for users and another one is for posts. So both the I will refresh it again. So if you see, the data is getting loaded from these both endpoints. The one is for users, and you will get list of different users, and one is for posts, for different posts. So let's say if it's going to be a static list, it is very easy. You will just like hard code the data, whatever going to come from the backend, and you will just validate it. But if it's going to be different data, you don't have to always try to get the latest data, right? Because for testing the UI, you just need some mock data. If you want to test this table, all you need is like some mock data to be populated here, right? So using WoW XSR, now I will show a demo how the table entries can be mocked here. Okay. So first, what we now need to do is how we created object for SpyDriver, we will create a new object for WoW XSR, and we will just pass whatever the driver we're going to use. So again, here you can use any web driver like Firefox or like Safari or remote web driver, whatever the web driver you're going to use, you just need to pass to it. And from the WoW XSR, you will get the mock driver. So using this driver, we're going to perform all our operations in the test here. So again, this is kind of a simple page object. We are going to the login page. Okay, I guess this is not. Okay, it's here. So you got a driver object here. So this is just a simple page object file. You will just pass the whatever driver you got to here. Now what I have done is I have already stored the list of dummy users to this JSON file, which is present under the resources folder. You see, I have just replaced it with my name for all the 10 entries there. Now, if we go to response mock test, okay. So what we're going to do is that we're going to read the JSON file and we're going to store that result as a list of user objects here. And now we need to add a mock. So adding a mock is as simple as like this. So wowxsr.mock, you need to add a mock here. So whenever an API call is made for this endpoint, when a get call is made to this endpoint, you need to have a mock response with this body. That's it. We don't have to do any other configuration. So whenever a get call made to this endpoint, just respond it with this mock body here. So that's it. Now you go to the URL, you go to the dashboard, and you see that the name should be displayed at Sudarshan. Let's quickly run this example. Okay, so now you can see, so if I go to dashboard, I will still see solution. I will go to a different page and I will come back to users. Still, you will see the mock response here. So not just walking, you can like, now currently we have just mocked the body, right? You can, similarly, you can also mock the status code. So if you see this methods, you can like update the body. So let's say if there are scenarios where like you want to check whether the loading indicator for any API call is displayed or not. So sometimes the API response might be very soon. So to test that loading functionality, you want to delay the response of the API, right? So you can add a delay here. So let's say whenever the user's API is made, delay it by let's say 30 seconds. So if we run this, so see, because the user's API call is not fulfilled for 30 seconds, right? That's why you're seeing this loading indicator. So even if you go to post and come back, it will still load because we have made that API to respond only after 30 seconds. So like there are a lot of other things you can do with this. So not just the response, you can also mock the request body. So let's say, so previously we saw how to mock a response body. Similarly, we can also mock whenever a request is made, you can also update the request body itself. So here in this example, what we can do is whenever a post request is made, we can update the body. So let's say in UI, you enter a valid username and password. You can forcefully update that username and password while making the API call. So this way you can like easily test a lot of negative scenarios or like error scenarios. So sometimes your application will behave differently when an API error happens, right? So you can easily mock those scenarios using this library. So yeah, so one other thing is like you can also get all the logs made from the application, right? So for that, you can simply use wow xhr dot. Log dot. So get XSR logs. So this will return a list of XSR log. So from that XSR log, you can get all this information like when at what time the API call has been initiated and when the API call gets completed, complete request information, what method it is, what is the URL, what is the request body, what are all the headers it has. And if you take the response, you can get what is the response status and what is the URL, what is the headers and what is the response body. So you'll get all this information. So this is also one thing which you can achieve using the WoW XHR here. So yeah, that's it for the WoW XHR. The one other thing is like I wanted to really share with the communities like this auto wait plugin. So if you take any modern JavaScript based automation tools, the first thing which they are telling is like unless Selenium, our tool is going to automatically wait for all the web element commands. So you don't have to explicitly manage the web element waits, right? So somehow I wanted to overcome the limitation which Selenium has, that is like automatically wait for an element before performing an interaction, eliminating the use of waits. So this wait plugin is really handy when you wanted to write a quick automation script, considering you don't want to add any wait statements. So I will also show a quick demo of it. So here, let's take a scenario where like I wanted to go to Amazon, search for a OnePlus, and I wanted to click the first search link, and I need to add the cart button, and I need to go to the cart page. So this is what I wanted to automate. But typically, if you ever used Selenium before, you know that this won't work, right? Because definitely there will be some delay before each and every action. So after entering the search term, there will be some delay for the results to be appear. So you need to add some certain wait statements. So this is how the original test looks. So if you use Selenium, so you need to wait for the search box. You need to wait for the search results. And then you need to wait for each every element to click, right? So what I have done is, it's a very simple plugin. So it's called a Selenium wait plugin. So what you will do is like, you create a Selenium wait plugin and you can pass any driver here. So here again, it is going to be Chrome driver or Firefox driver, whatever driver it's going to be. And it requires some options. What are all its few of important options is like default waiting. So how long does it automatically wait for an element? So here I have given 30 seconds. So you can ignore these parameters for now. So we have told the plugin to wait for 30 seconds before each element interaction is performed, right? So now I'm getting the driver and I'm not at all adding any wait statements here. What all I can do is like I can just simply run the test and it will work.
Navigated to www.amazon.in. Type value 1A+.
Sorry for that. I was just doing some experiment and I forgot to comment it out. So see, the test got passed. I haven't added any single wait statement here. So now let's see what happens for the same test if I remove that await plugin. I will just remove everything. And I will just give a normal web driver here. And let's see what happens. So see, it got failed because it cannot able to find this button here because the test didn't wait for this button to appear. So this is really very handy if you want to write a quick, simple Selenium automation script without spending much time on adding those unnecessary wait statements. So this is like, this also has like a lot of other features as well. So let's say if you are using any page object model, and you don't want this plugin to wait for certain methods, certain steps under that specific page object method, you can use this ignore wait function. So this annotation. So what this ignore wait annotation will do is like, so whenever a test is getting run, this particular plugin will check whether that particular web driver command is running under ignore wait annotation. If it, ignore wait annotation is present, it will just not wait for any interaction. It will just pass the control over to the Selenium itself. If the ignore wait annotation is not present, then it will wait for each and every interaction before making any interaction on the web element. So that's one functionality which this library can offer you. So again, this is open source. I have given the links for this repo in my PowerPoint as well. So you guys can like use it. It's kind of in very early stage because only very few are using in my current organization. So you all can give it a try and like report any issues so that we can make this plugin even more stabler and the community can use it, right? So yeah. So having said that, like I have came to the end of this session now. So thanks a lot for patiently listening my entire presentation and being here. Yeah. I will now hand over the control to the moderators.
Yeah, there are three questions.
Okay.
Get them out. Yeah. What is the key difference between WebDriver Event Listener and SpyDriver? Since WebDriver Event Listener also has capabilities of printing before and after logs without adding manual logs.
Okay. So the one of the main key differences is like, so WebDriver Event Listener is it's an individual class. So unless like let's say if you take a Chrome driver implements extends a remote web driver and it implements the web driver interface. So the typecasting can be done. So even if you go on to type like downcast to web upcast to web driver, you can do it. Again, you can downcast to Chrome driver, that is possible. But if you are going to create a web driver event listener, you cannot typecast it back to the Chrome driver or you cannot typecast it back to remote web driver. But in case of Spy driver, that is possible. So you create an object for Chrome driver, you can cast it to any object that Chrome driver has, right? So you can cast it back to remote web driver on call any methods that is available in the remote web driver. But in case of web driver event listener, you cannot cast it back to remote web driver or something or the other. So that's the key difference between the spy driver and the remote web driver.
The next question is, will HXR work for HTTPS?
Yeah, it will. It will work for both HTTP and HTTPS as well.
Okay. And can we ignore wait with Cucumber?
Yeah, it works. So it's a normal Java annotation. You just need to annotate ignore wait for any Java methods and it should work. It doesn't matter whether you use Cucumber or TestNG or any test framework.
The next question is, wonderful to see Spy Driver and Auto Wait plugins. Can we extend them to use for mobile drivers as well?
Yeah, currently Spy Driver do have support for APM as well, but still it's not completely tested. So if you can use it and if you can provide a suggestion, I'm happy to help. Yeah, yeah.
And the last question is, any plugins for Shadow DOM element in future?
I haven't had any plans for that, but if there is a necessity, then we can surely work on it. Yeah.
Okay, so here ends the Q&A session. Thank you so much, Sudarshan.
Thanks all.
Thank you, Sudarshan.